Hey folks, welcome back. Chris Garlock here with Michael Redmond, 9-Don Professional. And of course, this is our AlphaGo versus the World Series and special treat as we're coming into our last section of games. We've had a number of very kind of cool things. I'm going to leave it to you, Michael, to explain what is going on that is different in this game.
Okay, this is game 55. It's Chen Yaoye's third try against AlphaGo, okay. But it seems that this was a kind of a team game. So he teaming up with Meng Tailing, who was also a player who played AlphaGo a number of times.
Right.
So I don't really know exactly how it worked. actually, I don't think it's a good idea. In the Chinese, the Go Summit that was in May of 2017,
yeah,
they actually had human players were allowed to team up with AlphaGo.
I remember, yeah.
Yeah, and I think that's a good idea. I think that was something that actually was working fairly well. But with top human players, the stronger the human players are, the more their styles are going to clash. And it's going to give them problems, actually. So I'm not really that keen on the idea of teams. But it's an interesting thing to try. I think it was a good thing for them to try it out in this series.
Maybe you'll explain as we go. I mean, do you pick up any of that in the play? Is it are there places where you think, you know, you see different people's style?
Well, basically, if they've studied together, then if they have studied various openings or joseki, local positions together, then they will feel comfortable with playing those moves, knowing that they have the same idea of what the correct sequence is going to be.
Mm-hmm.
And so in that case, there's no problem. But if they get into a position where they're not sure how their partner feels about a choice in joseki or something like that, then sometimes they can feel hesitant to play the special moves that they would rather play themselves, but they play something that is relatively normal, something that they know their partner will recognize, you might say. Mm-hmm. That is something that I would call a drawback to having a pair game like this.
Let's take a look at it.
I'm not sure it happened in this game. This is actually a situation that we've seen before in some of the matches. When Black does play this approach in the lower left corner, AlphaGo will play the attachment underneath every time. And this is a move that was always popular, attaching underneath. And it's become even more popular now, because if you ask a computer program, it's almost always the suggested move. It's just the fact that if Black plays like this, then White is quickly establishing the value that White should be getting some value for having played the first move in the lower left corner here. And this value in this joseki, the value is immediately translated into something like 15 points of territory, which we can already map out, as I have a rough borderline where White does actually have 15 points. It's a very easy to calculate advantage, local advantage that White has established here. And Black will probably play something towards the side, but Black's position actually is not territory yet. It's just a position. And so White has firmly established a local advantage as a result of playing the first move in that corner. And so it makes sense. It's a very successful approach for White. And Black plays the avalanche joseki. And this is something that I think all players, especially amateur players, can pick up on, is the fact that AlphaGo does not bother to play the complicated variations in this joseki in the lower left. Like you will see human players playing here sometimes. In this case, when there's a black stone on a star point in the upper right, the latter is going to favor black. So you would get into this variation. And if white curls on the second line, black's going to cut on the third line here. So that would be bad. So this is a bit problematic for white. So maybe you'll see white extend here and get into this variation. This is another very complicated joseki. Like there's... it's this maybe the second most complicated joseki that can still be played in professional play. Like it's this joseki or the taisha joseki that are super complicated. And there was a period where people were just putting out new moves one after the other. There's so much area that even now it's not completely researched. Mm. AlphaGo doesn't bother with that. So this is that joseki that I was talking about is so complicated that even pros, it can be dangerous. A lot of casual players will just find it very intimidating to get into that joseki. And the fact that AlphaGo says that it actually likes this variation better, it makes it easy for people to avoid all those complications. This is, according to AlphaGo, and according to modern computer programs, it's better to play here when you compare it with those joseki choices. So if it's better and it's simpler, what more can you ask?
I don't have to convince me.
And so I think this is really very good news for all those amateurs who are having trouble. And actually, to be honest, some professionals also.
The secret is out.
So this is a point where Black extended. The suggested move is to jump. It's just a little bit better to jump. I really like this jump. Black already has a line of four stones. So there's really no weak point that will be caused when White wedges in here. Black will just answer like this. It's no problem. There's no weak points to speak of. And so it's better for Black to have a more active position with the jump here than just extending here. A slight difference. White plays here. We've seen this before. And as I told you in a previous game, I still find it surprising that the computer program still wants Black to connect to attach underneath. It doesn't seem to be working with the wall, but actually when White plays here, Black will probably play some kind of a pincer, for instance, something like this. And so Black is going to make use of the wall in this general area. But attaching underneath is just something that would not occur to a professional player at the time, at least. So Black pincers, White plays here. And I think we even have this board position in a previous game. Black is supposed to play here and crawl underneath, in which case the game would still be fairly close. It would still be about even. But once Black gets into the traditional joseki, it's going to be more than 50% for White. So when Black plays here and White plays here, this is something like 55% for White. And Black is going to win by something like 4 points before komi, so White will have 2.5 points of komi left over. According to Kadago, that is.
Of course. Like,
it's not as if I'm going to calculate that for you.
I knew you had a calculator now.
And this is the suggested move. This is a really weird move where Black is going to connect here. And this was the biggest surprise I got out of this opening. Like, I could have understood Black playing underneath like this.
Right.
Which would probably be slight advantage for White. But connecting here, it looks like such clunky shape, but actually the cut here is fairly effective. Closer to an even game, I guess, when Black extends here or something like this. Maybe Black plays here.
Wow.
Or maybe Black plays a pincer on the side. There's various ways it can continue. But Black does have defense on the upper side. So we get into this joseki, and we've seen this before. It's just bad for Black. Black tries. We've seen Black playing a hane underneath here in a different game. In this game, Black tries something different. So it's about the same. It's not working anyway.
It's too big a corner for White, right?
It's a big corner. There are various things that Black can do with it later. But the more you do, the worse it gets. Like, the suggested move actually is for Black just to cover here, let White take the corner and play here. And it turns out clamping here and hopefully closing off the side there to set up this move and get a kind of a quasi territory here. Start building territory in this area is really important. And I think that the hidden meaning to the fact that computer programs are continually in this position, they will be continually suggesting that Black should surround this side. I think the hidden meaning there is that this white stone, the cutting stone here, actually has a good deal of potential to be moving out into the center at some point. And so black has to consolidate the general area and prevent white from doing that. We're going to see the opposite happen in the game. Black pincers here, white plays here. So this was a point where the game is already apparently very bad for black. Let's see.
Well, white's just territory. I mean, black doesn't have anything yet.
Black doesn't have anything. That corner is too big. And black plays here. Messing with the corner, trying to reduce it, actually was not a good idea. And the moment black does this, this actually reduces his winning percentage to 33%.
Yeah.
And that translates to 0 points before Komi. And so just to repeat what I was saying before, black has to build on the left side. So if we're looking just at the corner, it seems that black's best sequence is just to try to play forcing moves like this. If black gets to force like this, this will be a success for black. Just black really wants to concentrate on building this area so that the potential for this stone does not come to the light of day. It's very important for black to do that. In the game, black starts messing with the corner. This is counterproductive because now white can slide here.
Yeah.
And if we go back, well, actually, even now black can probably, and this is just getting worse. So at some point, black has to close off the side. So maybe now,
I just want to ask a question because that black move in the corner, I mean, is that, it must
black
be a
is real, looking at the cutting point
real
there?
Move, but the clamp that you showed, the recommended move, looks so good. Why would black play that move at B6?
It's interesting. Black actually had various moves here. Another move that locally works is to cut here. Black can actually cut here and capture the one white stone. If white plays on this side, black can curl around, and you can see that it's not possible for white to cover on the second line. So white would have to sacrifice that stone. But the point is that this is just, it loses a tempo. So white would probably start attacking the left side with something like this. And it's not fast enough. So that's why sometimes in some positions, it's suggested that it's better for black to play this clamp. To play this and then the clamp. Actually, even if black does this, white will probably play away. So the real danger is that white is going to attack the left side first.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why the computer program at this point, Lilo Zero was suggesting that black just plays the side first. And if white slides here, black can attach here and cut. And if white extends, this is going to be bad for white in the corner. This is just not going to work for white in the corner. Black will capture that corner group. So white has to capture the one stone. Black does get to close off the side and start to build this area. So it was very important for black to do that because pretty soon we are going to see this stone make some action. So the clamp was obviously better. But I think the fact that black had so many various possible moves here, this move also is threatening the cut at some point. So the fact that black had these various options of moves for black to try out made it a bit more confusing and probably was a kind of a block to just allowing white to keep the whole corner. Black, there was the feeling that black wanted to get something more. But, you know, trying to live in the corner is just a very bad idea. And black does it again. White's just going to leave that. And now you see black has lost the option to playing here. If black does that now, black will not be able to close off the side. And so that you can see that exchange in the corner had this negative effect. It means there's no good way for black to surround the side. Like if black plays here, white will just capture the one stone. That will be that would be real even worse. This is the worst variation. And the game black doesn't do anything, but it means that white is reducing the one big area that black had. And then later on, white will be attacking it with this. I think this sort of demonstrates
what
the basic problem in black's attitude was. Black does have, in the corner, black has this move, which can set up a ko in the corner, for instance. And white's just going to leave it again. It's not important enough for white to bother with that. In fact, I think this didn't really happen almost throughout the game. This is one of the games that went to the end. And in the end, they actually lost by only 1.5 points. But at this point in the game, they're already losing by a huge margin, even before Komi. Like, white's winning by several points on the board.
Wow.
Without Komi. And it's just the fact that white is going to capture, white is going to, let's see, go back to the game. White's going to capture those three black stones. Actually, I think this is a game that maybe I did a commentary for AGA. Maybe there's a video, an AGA video where I did a commentary for this game.
Okay.
And I was admiring the fact that white was taking this profit on the left and allowing black to play what looked like a key point. But this, and black is going to try to surround this area. This is all black really has left to do, but it's not very successful. Like, black eventually gets some territory there, but it was on a very reduced scale. It was just not enough. And white is already capturing these stones on the left. So this capture here, just very slowly and solidly building a white territory in that area, which was supposed to be a black moyo.
Right.
Was so successful. That was the decisive attack, you might say.
That's sort of the move that I love in this game is C11. C11 is a really elegant move.
It's a simple move, isn't it?
It doesn't completely erase Black's moyo, but it's just lovely.
That black doesn't have, it's not attractive for black to even try to surround any territory now. It's just so discouraging.
Right. And I think, and this is sort of what you were getting at, is that black in the end, if you look at where black winds up, you know, having to make his territory, it's sort of in the hardest place to make the territory as opposed to earlier.
This was black's big area. It was the big area that black had to build on.
Right.
And he just didn't do it, and he tried to do it in a more roundabout fashion.
Right.
It just didn't work.
And I wonder, and you know, there's no way of knowing, but I wonder if, you know, to your point, if having, you know, two players, you know, could have hindered, you know, you could have had a couple of different ideas there, because it almost, and I don't know that I knew this when we did the original commentary, but looking at it now and knowing that, it almost does feel like there are different ideas about where to play, you know, where the area is, and that could have been a factor. Who knows?
In general, that is something that happens. I don't think I really, at the time, I didn't know. I think I just had the name Chen Yaoye,
right?
And I didn't know that Meng Tailing was helping him. So
right.
But I think that was something that DeepMind announced later, maybe.
Gotcha. All right. Fascinating game, as always. Thank you so much, Michael. Thanks, everybody, for watching. Hope you are enjoying these. Please do keep on commenting. We read and I do respond to your comments. So keep those coming. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.